Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. I'm going to ask our debaters here to take a seat in the comfy chairs. And I want to welcome you and thank you for coming this evening. My name is Kurt Volker. I have the honor of being the executive director of the McCain Institute, a part of Arizona State University that is named for Senator McCain, Mrs. McCain, and the McCain family here going back several generations. It's an honor to the legacy of service of that family to our country. The McCain Institute has been part of ASU for about 4 years, and our principal focus is promoting character-driven leadership in the United States and around the world. How do we instill good values and good character in a next generation of leaders who will deal with the challenges that our country and our world is facing? We also take on particular projects in areas of humanitarian work, human rights, law and governance, national security, so that we can try to function as an action-oriented do tank ourselves. What can we accomplish as a small but determined NGO, as an entity, rather than merely as a think tank? We like to have interesting thoughts, but we're more interested in what we can accomplish than just publishing papers or holding conferences. But one of the things in our charter has also been to stimulate a culture of debate about the choices that we face as a country and as a global community. What are the challenges and how do we deal with them? And so we launched a debate and decision series with that in mind. I think we've held probably close to 20 debates now on different topics, things such as, should we get out of Afghanistan? Should the United States intervene in Syria? Is Iran a threat, a nuclear threat? Is cutting our defense budget a gift to our enemies? And on and on and on. We've done China, we've done human rights, we've done all sorts of topics. Today's topic, I think, is a very timely one and a very exciting one, very appropriate for the Cronkite School of Journalism, where we are here at ASU. The topic is, how can the United States win the information wars? And let me explain very briefly what that question means. We are in competition with ISIS for hearts and minds. We're in competition with Russia. We're in competition with China. This is not new. The United States has always been in a competition for hearts and minds, promoting our values of freedom, democracy, market economy, rule of law, human rights, sometimes with greater success, sometimes with lesser success. But in today's environment, we see extraordinarily proactive and successful efforts from many of our adversaries to shape beliefs and attitudes, shape hearts and minds around the world. And the question is the U.S. winning or losing? And the fact is, we couldn't find anyone to argue the U.S. is winning. So we had to reshape the question to be, how can the United States win? And we've assembled a panel of really world-renowned experts to introduce ideas about how we can do a better job tackling this set of issues. I'll leave the introductions of the panel to our moderator, and let me now introduce our moderator. The moderator for this discussion is Jeff Cunningham. Jeff is a member of the Board of Trustees of the McCain Institute. He is a faculty member here at the Cronkite School and will be joining the faculty of Thunderbird coming up. He is a former publisher of Forbes magazine. He is currently leading a digital series called Iconic Voices, and you've seen advertisements for that in the lobby as you came up, which is interviews with very prominent, very interesting figures from really all walks of life that creates a digital archive of these interviews. People that he has interviewed include Warren Buffett or Michael Milken, the CEO of Freeport-McMoRan here in Phoenix, Richard Adkerson, CEO of GE, Jeff Immelt. Jeff Immelt also happens to be on our McCain Institute Board of Trustees as well, and many, many others. In addition to Forbes magazine, he was a publisher of American Heritage magazine. He founded Directorship magazine. He was in the leadership of the National Association of Corporate Directors. He's had an extraordinarily distinguished career that straddles both business and board memberships and publishing. So Jeff will be leading our discussion here and moderating the Q&A. When we do debates as a McCain Institute, we try to impose a little bit of order in order to bring out the best arguments. Rather than a panel discussion where people just present, we pose questions, we try to time answers to make it fair and equal for everyone, and we push back, and we try to get responses to opposing points of view. And that's what we hope to provide for you this evening as well. It is being live webcast. It is will be available as a digital archive afterwards, and it is part of the series that we do of debate and decision events for the McCain Institute. With that, and without any further ado, let me invite our moderator, Jeff Cunningham, to come to the stage.
Thank you, Kurt.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you. You'll have more to applaud when I'm finished, believe me. So very good to be with you. My job is simply to be the docent and point the way towards the rock stars. And I'll tell you a little bit about the session today, what we have in mind. The airwaves are flooded with images of refugees, terror, outrage. And the reason they're flooded with those images is because we are in something called the information war. More pointedly, the war for hearts and minds. It's a war that only generals dream about. The U.S. enjoys every conceivable tactical advantage. The technology and the media being used and the tools are American, largely speaking, and our resources are unlimited. And yet one pundit said about America's strategy, too much George Patton, not enough Steve Jobs. Of our current efforts, Ken Weinstein, a member of the Broadcasting Board of Governors to Policy Wonks, that's BBG, and you're going to hear a lot about BBG tonight, said U.S. communication strategy needs to rebuild from the ground up. The resources aren't being squandered either. State Department estimates that the Russians spend $1.5 billion on essentially propaganda, while the BBG is hoping for an additional, at the time this was written, $15 million to deal with Russia and the Islamic State. And help may be on the way. You'll hear about House Committee Foreign Affairs Chairman Ed Royce and H.R. 2323, which is a bill designed to reform the BBG and bring in a full-time CEO on Capitol Hill. I ask, is that a remedy or a magic potion? As is happening with some of our political primaries, the BBG may be time to shake up the team. Let me tell you about our panel and why they are particularly able to discuss and debate this issue. This is to my left and on your left as well. Matt Armstrong is a member of the Broadcasting Board of Governors, thought leader on public diplomacy. He serves as the Secretary of the Public Diplomacy Council, sits on the editorial board of the Journal of the NATO Strategic Communications Center of Excellence. He chairs the Special Committee on the Voice of America in the 21st Century. To Matt's left is David Ensor. He is the former director of the Voice of America and currently executive VP of the Atlantic Council. He spent a semester at the Harvard Kennedy School writing about international broadcasting and digital media. David's an Emmy-nominated broadcast journalist. 32-year career includes CNN's national security correspondent, and prior to that, an ABC News global correspondent. Moving one over is Ambassador Alberto Fernandez, Vice President, Middle East Media Research Institute. He has served as a U.S. Foreign Service officer in Iraq, Kuwait, Nicaragua, Dominican Republic, and the United Arab Emirates, and as the State Department's coordinator for the Center of Strategic Counterterrorism Communications, and as U.S. Ambassador to the Republic of Equatorial Guinea. He's also held a variety of Foreign Service roles in the Republic of Sudan, Afghanistan, Jordan, Syria, and Guatemala. No comments about the garden spots you've been sent to, Ambassador. Jeffrey Gedman, down there to my far left, is former president and CEO of Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, reporting directly to the BBG, the Broadcasting Board of Governors. Today, he is a senior fellow at Georgetown University's School of Foreign Service and a senior fellow at the Institute for Strategic Dialogue in London. With that out of the way, gentlemen, let's begin our debate. I'd like to toss out a question. We call it the information war. Ambassador, would you take a crack at this? Are we exaggerating for political reasons? And if we are not, what are the consequences of losing this information war?
Well, I don't think we're exaggerating the challenge of information war. information is a tool like any other tool that you use in a struggle for ideas, a struggle for supremacy, for power, for influence in the world. Influencing people, you can do that politically, you can do it economically, you can do it on the battlefield, and you also can do it in that most important space, the space between people's ears. So the question is, does the United States have a role to play in this ideological, intellectual, emotional battlefield? I would say absolutely. And in fact, one of the problems that we face is that we have not treated it with the priority and the urgency and the importance that many of our adversaries have. The Islamic State prioritizes propaganda more than the United States does. They actually pay their propagandists more than they pay their fighters. The Russians, you know, have hired a troll army to go online to basically fill the space and contest the space and put out the message that they have. So our adversaries and our you know, others who are challenging us think that this is really important. We should do so the same.
Before I ask for a follow-up, I'd like to get the clock started, please. Matt, I'll turn to you. Who is the enemy?
That's a good question. First, thank you. Thank you, McCain Institute. Thank you, Kurt. It's a good question. If I can follow up on Alberto's comment, just to encapsulate that, the priority is just not there. And so if you don't have the understanding that public opinion matters in this day when states have less autonomy to control within their borders and individuals have greater freedom to influence others as well as to cause disruption and destruction, the public opinion of individuals and of groups matters tremendously. So the enemy is a hard term because we have so many different audiences, we have so many different adversaries, that I would phrase it that there are a number of adversaries. Some are more fatal if we don't engage quickly. Some others are going to take time to really engage. So the adversaries here are those that are actively working against our national security and our foreign policy.
Before
can I say
yes, please.
There's one other adversary, David. Ignorance. Ignorance is a very serious enemy of ours. When people are well informed, they make better decisions. And I have a lot of confidence in American values. They're not just American. They're, you might call them Western, or in any case, the ideas that around which our society is organized. If those ideas can be projected with honest information attached, a lot of people would like to have them. So I think one of our biggest enemies is ignorance.
David, let's turn this into a town hall. I'm going to give you four choices. Just raise your hand. You can't be wrong, okay? Who is our most significant adversary in the information war? And you certainly can raise your hand more than once. Islamic State. Russia. Iran. China. So China wins. Jeffrey, what do you think about that?
I think that they all won because in this unscientific poll, we got hands on all of them. And I think it depends on what you mean by the question. I mean, globally, China is a rising power and has to be contended with. Russia is not a rising power, but it's a power that's decided it can play a weak hand very strongly, and look at what it's doing. It's trying to divide and weaken Europe and build this Russia up by cutting America down. ISIS is another kettle of fish altogether, too. I mean, this is a group that not only is waging war with the West, it's waging war in the Islamic world. Most people killed by ISIS are not Christians or Jews, actually. They're Muslims. And that is a different kind of war with a different kind of scope. So anyway, I'm just going to tell you, you're all right, but some of you forgot to raise your hands the whole time.
Ambassador, you spent some time in that part of the world, in the Islamic State part of the world. Why is their approach, why does it appear to be so effective? And when I say effective, I'm talking about their ability to use it for recruitment.
Well, of course, they're extraordinarily effective and a revolutionary success in relative terms. You know, sometimes we go to extremes, right? There seems to be an extreme when you talk about ISIS. It's either this is insignificant or, my God, it's World War III. The reality is neither one of those. This is an extraordinary, revolutionary, powerful challenge. Not to us. It's a challenge in the Muslim world among Muslims. It's a challenge for authority, for power, for leadership. At the same time, despite the extraordinary success of the Islamic State, the extraordinary success that tens of thousands of foreigners have joined it, thousands of people have left the comfort of life in the West to go to Syria, to go to Raqqa, and to Mosul to join the Islamic State. Despite that extraordinary success, they still have been able to mobilize only a tiny minority of the Muslim world. But, you know, this is revolution. This is what the Islamic State is trying to propose or trying to set. It's the storming of the Winter Palace in 1917. You know, it's the euphoria of utopia is coming, the end of the world is coming, and this is powerful. This is heady, especially if you are young and stupid, as many, you know, of the people that are attracted tend to be.
David, let me turn to you. Maybe we want to examine the word stupid for a moment.
Shallow.
Ignorant,
uninformed.
Perhaps. Because, ignorant. Now, this is reaching here, but it's a question of the effectiveness of what we're calling digital media, okay? The whole world, social media, digital media, websites, non-broadcast television, non-print media. And we're seeing a minor example of that in our own country, in our own primaries. And now, we're not, for those who want to get a quote here and say that I'm saying ISIS is like Bernie Sanders, I am not saying that, okay? I'm just saying we're seeing people who knew nothing about a candidate, who knew nothing about the state he was from, get very energized. And in some ways, their detractors might say that they're ignorant, or they might say that this guy's tapping into something that's really important. If you will sanitize ISIS or Islamic State's approaches to their business for a moment and just look at them as a marketing organization, are they tapping into something that we need to tap into, David?
They're making, for what they are trying to do, brilliant use of digital media. And it is fascinating to watch because, just in terms of the sort of production values and their ability to pull attention to themselves, I sometimes envy them. But you know, I mean, ISIS is using the pornography of violence, which does attract mostly young men in a certain way, in a way that ultimately is destructive not only to everyone else but to them as well. But it has a certain quality to it that pulls people in. And it's something we have to, as the ambassador said, we simply have to face it and find our own way to communicate in that space, which is something you worked a lot on when you were at the State Department. I ran a broadcasting organization that was trying to do news, honest news. But I very strongly believe the U.S. government also needs to be, if you are, will, in the gray area too, of fighting and fighting hard against recruiting websites, against the ideas that ISIS is trying, the sick ideas that ISIS is trying to sell. And frankly, also, if we can shut down some of their ways of getting on the web, we should be doing that. There should be a much more serious and, I think, controlled at the highest level in the U.S. government effort over several different spaces. Journalism, broadcasting, is only one of them.
If I could just add on to that one point. Those are important words, but there's a great misconception when we talk about takfiri Salafi jihadist organizations like ISIS. Their appeal is revolutionary, it's extraordinary, but it is not sick or perverse. The strongest thrust of the ISIS appeal is positive, not negative. You know, we see the snuff videos and we see the kind of the beheadings and all of that, and we say, oh, this is horrible. But actually, the overwhelming bulk of what they put out is aspiring people to a greater ideal. In that, they are like Nazis, like communists, like other revolutionaries. It's not about the evil they do. Of course, everything they do is evil, but what they present is a positive vision of the world, which is powerful and convincing and put out with a revolutionary fervor. And one of the problems we face when we talk about the information war is, what is our vision? What are we talking about? Those values that you talk about, those American values, which are also universal, how do we present those in a fresh, extraordinary, and powerful way, the way that they're doing?
Matt Armstrong, we're having a debate really about the message, and I want to turn it, because we're going to come back to that, I want to turn it a little bit to the messenger. Is it also the case that our adversaries, the two we're mentioning, are playing the long game, and we don't know how to play the long game?
I think that's part of it. I think a more central piece, particularly with the issue that we're talking about now with Daesh, is we're not the right people to be engaged in the conversation. We are naturally an outsider. Part of what Daesh is able to leverage is this interpretation of Islam, the fact that you can't question Islam, the structure of the conversations. And we're not in a position, we're not appropriate to get into that conversation, and we tend not to do it very well when we get there. So our focus should be more, how do we enable Muslims to question, to push, to reject some of these notions? And so that does get into who is the messenger. And for this part of the conversation, because so much of the influence is occurring in a domain that we have no credibility in, we have to empower those that have the credibility to stand up and question. Now, there are other market spaces, such as with Russia, where their big power, yes, as Alberto said, as Jeff said, their big power here is really the undermining of democracy. The question more is really a brilliant tagline for Russia today. It's great because they don't want you to come up with an answer. They want you to question the whole utility, vitality of the whole democratic process, of alliances, of the news media itself. And in that way, it is a tremendous threat. Regardless of what Russia is going to do, it is a threat to the whole Western project.
Jeffrey Gedman, is it possible that, as journalist Luke Harding said, Putin's actions are following a classic KGB doctrine? The goal is to create divisions in NATO and use the refugee community as a way to undermine Europe and to undermine the West. Is it possible that they haven't forgotten the lessons of the past and we have?
Well, let me, Jeff, before I answer that, I will answer that in just a moment. I do want to suggest for this entire conversation that we put it in a context, because this entire information debate, whether we're winning, losing, how to win, has to be seen, I think, in a bigger debate. It occurred to me as I heard the colleague speaking a moment ago, in the context of where we are in the United States and where American foreign policy is. The fact is 2008 happened. The fact is going into Iraq was a problem. The fact is getting out of Iraq was a problem. And the fact is we have a pretty turbulent, untidy, complex election process right now. That's us in the world, and we have some homework to do. The second point is, I think important, is when we finally get American foreign policies right, vis-a-vis China, vis-a-vis Russia, vis-a-vis ISIS, that will make this conversation a lot easier, because I think in many circles, in many places around the world, people think that America's in retreat and losing, and winning counts a lot. First point. Second point to your question, lessons of the Cold War. I think there's no doubt about it that to understand this Russia is to look at the person of Vladimir Putin. It's a system and culture around him, but the person of Vladimir Putin. And people say he's a nationalist, okay. People say he's an authoritarian, okay. But he is a KGB man, okay. Now, some of you know what that means, and some of you are too young to know what that means. You know, I have Georgetown students who say, oh, you mean like the FBI or something like that. No, this is a level of culture that prizes lying as an art and science, deception in every level of life.
So you're saying
and
a politician,
he is good
I'm
at
sorry.
It. And he is good at it. So I'll just finish with one point. gosh, you know, the equivalent of the KGB in East Germany was the Stasi. Guess what they found a few years ago, 2009 to be precise, in the Stasi archives by accident. They found out that a key moment during the peace movement in West Germany, a West German policeman shot a student protester in the back of the head, and it ignited protests throughout the country. Guess what? He was a Stasi KGB agent, shot him in the back of the head. So all I'm saying is, we proceed, I think, with a level of innocence and naivete that makes Vladimir Putin lick his chops every night. I think he finds us like a walk in the park.
This is a bit of a complicated walk in the park. I'll turn to Ambassador. If you examine our moves in the last year with Syria and with Iran, how do we put out a cohesive message to whatever we would call the Islamic world, given the way in which we, given our relationship between what's happening in Syria and with Iran?
Well, I mean, whether we intend to put one out or not, the message has been received. The message that is received certainly in most of the Muslim world, especially in the Sunni Arab Muslim world, is that the United States is weak, the United States is in retreat, and the United States is either cynical or criminal and in the pocket of the Iranians. You know, it was fascinating to watch the president a few days ago do a very nice thing, a very good thing, and go to a mosque in Baltimore and, you know, show his solidarity with American Muslims. In the Arab world, when that happened, what people were talking about was Aleppo, and Aleppo being cut off and the advance of the Russians in Aleppo, and it did not reflect well on U.S. values or U.S. foreign policy or U.S. tolerance. So that narrative, the narrative that we are both weak and duplicitous, of course, is extraordinarily helpful to the Islamic State. You talk about Iraq. The narrative of the Islamic State and of the Salafi jihadists is this. The Americans went into Iraq to overthrow a Sunni Arab Muslim dictator. And the Americans refused to go in Syria to keep a non-Sunni Arab Muslim dictator in power. So they see it, you know, this, you can say this is a conspiracy theory, you can say that this is crazy, but they've drawn real conclusions from our actions. Jeff is absolutely right. I mean, one of the problems when we talk about the information war is that we divorce it from foreign policy. I call it public diplomacy magic pixie dust. You know, if only we put some magic pixie dust on this problem, it will go away. Well, if the foreign policy is lousy, you know, no matter of, you know, kind of silk is going to make that lousy or acceptable.
David, we're dealing with what I'd call unitary doctrinaire regimes, single belief or single focus. Does it make it difficult, if not impossible, for a democracy, getting back to the information war, to wage war against regimes for which physical war and information war are parallel?
Parallel, you mean they're all part of the same thing?
They're reconciled.
Yeah, I mean, look, I might have lower expectations for our struggle on the information side than maybe some do. I agree with the ambassador, you can't put lipstick on a pig, you know, so if the policies aren't good, no matter what you do in information, it's not going to do all that well. But I really do think we could be doing more of this, we should be doing more of this, and even if we're not sure what our foreign policy should be, we should be doing a better job of information policy. In Pakistan, when I was VOA director, very difficult country. It's a country where over a long period of time, the government, members of the government have deliberately fanned the flames of anti-Americanism, where the government has deliberately supported and given succor to the Taliban for complicated, weird Pakistani reasons. They've supported a terrorist group living in their midst and attacking the country next door, and it's now coming back to bite them. So it's a really screwed up place. When I came in, we decided to try to not to try to do news broadcasting so much in Pakistan, but to take it back more to the people-to-people level, because there was such difficulty with, you know, drone attacks. You know, if you report them as news, you're riling people up. So we decided to just go back to the people-to-people basis to, for example, invite a young Pakistani woman journalist to come to the United States for a year, travel around the country, meet people, and do whatever stories seemed appropriate to explain our country to theirs, to show that normal people in America have similar wishes, desires, dreams, as young Pakistanis do, to show what young Pakistanis' lives are like when they come to American universities, which many of them aspire to do. And so even if you can't, you know, solve the problems of foreign policy, I think there's important work that can and should be done and isn't being done at the level it should be done around the world to help build understanding of our country and to make friends, frankly, for our country.
Matt, I'm going to give you a question so that you can tell me that you won't answer my question, you'll answer yours. Is that okay?
Well, let's see what your question is.
Is the challenge, and we talked about BBG and the structural issues, is the challenge with our poor strategy that we have an organization that is too poor to create good strategy?
Okay, so I can combine my answers. Here we go. So the question earlier had to do with, is democracy compatible with the information war and fighting the information war? The answer is absolutely yes. So I'm writing this book, I've been writing this book for years now, hopefully I'll be done this year, on the foundation of these activities, and it's 1917 to 1948, and I'll tell you the working title, which I think is appropriate for this environment, and it's How Exporting the First Amendment Created the Voice of America. Now, it's actually about public diplomacy, U.S. public diplomacy, but it was catchier to just say Voice of America. It's also the public affairs officers and all that stuff. And what I find that in this early part of the Cold War, it was absolutely compatible. And what we did, we realized that public opinion matters. Perceptions matter. You had a congressman, Carl Mundt, who said, because of the lack of information, and yet we were doing things to help the Europeans, not least of which to get rid of the Nazis, he said, we're creating a generation of Europeans that have full bellies but whose minds are turned against us because of the communist propaganda. So we created this peacetime environment of information that was compatible and worked with and supported with our foreign policy. And it was a foreign policy that all it needed to be known was it needed to be known. It was something that could stand on its own. There was no lipstick on a pig necessary. There was no redirection, change of subject that was necessary. And you move on a couple of years, and the USIA was created to streamline the State Department so that it could focus more on its foreign policies, to create a single accountable place for these broad information programs, which included libraries, exchanges, posters, magazines, books, and then, by the way, a relatively small, it was less than a quarter of the budget, this broadcasting element. And that was part of a streamlining of integrating the Defense Department and the State Department all together in 1953, and we've forgotten all that. And so here we are in these past 10, 20 years, really, I would argue, early 70s, when I think we had a shift from minds and wills, the struggle for minds and wills, to boomers and bombers, negotiations behind closed doors. In 1972, Senator Fulbright, who was attempting to abolish all of the radios, Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, Voice of America, and then went after USIA, said it's time for the radios to take their rightful place in the graveyard of Cold War relics. That was 1972. There was a shift. We haven't caught back up to the early part of that Cold War, when there were not walls up, public opinion mattered. So what you have now is there's that. And now with the BBG, I think we're finally getting the house in order. We have, you made a comment about this HR 2323. At this point, we have a CEO. 2323, we split the organizations into one unaccountable to the taxpayer organization with its own CEO, own board. The White House, Congress doesn't have a say in that. And then this other thing. But right now, we have a CEO who we need to have fully empowered so that if my job even exists anymore, it's to create a firewall. But if we have an empowered CEO, once again, we get to a place where it's a single point of accountability, coordinating the enterprises of these news and information tools. So part of it is we're getting to this point. The priority of news and information is not well understood. You made the comment about the funding. The BBG last year was authorized to spend $22 million in Russian language programming. So when you compare the BBG budget to the Russian budgets. 22 million versus a lot more in the Russian languages. It's a difficult thing. Plus, when you look at when we raise RT, you can't say Russia Today without Sputnik and without a couple of other products. And the BBG, just for point of reference, is not authorized, funded, or oriented to combat, to compete, to engage in the same space that RT is in. They're two separate actors in two environments.
Could you explain RT for those here who may not be familiar?
Oh, sorry. So RT is Russia Today. They did a clever rebranding, and they dropped Russia Today. It's just RT now. You can learn all sorts of remarkable things. I think there are two fun things to do if you ever watch RT. Google the speakers that are on their panels and find out what their real backgrounds are. And the other is, what interesting fact can you learn? For example, I was watching RT and I learned that the lack of badger rights in the United Kingdom is symbolic of Western hypocrisy in Africa. That's a true story.
Well, and when the Malaysian Airjet was shot down over Ukraine, and the world's media were reporting on increasing evidence that the missile that fired it down was a Russian-made missile and that it had come from a part of Ukraine that was occupied by the Russian-backed rebels, what was RT reporting? Well, they had something new every news cycle. They said, oh, this is probably a CIA plot, or, oh, they were trying to shoot down Putin's plane. Or, they had a new one every cycle. The point was not, as you said earlier, the point was not to elucidate. The point was to confuse, to create smoke in the air so that the clarity of the information that was coming out everywhere else would not be so clear to some audiences.
They're operating, then, I would say, again, to sanitize the content, much like what I do. I work with venture capital and digital media and startups. And the way you described it would be the perfect business plan for a startup wanting to break into the space. So why are they beating us? We invented startups. We invented digital media.
Well, I think you have to...
Open it up to all of you, by the way.
I think you have to break down that, how are they beating us? I think in the space of RT, there's a quick tendency to overinflate their actual impact. They've done a remarkable job in that we look at a spectrum. It's a linear spectrum. You have the far left and you have the far right. For RT, they've bent it. So they appeal to the far left and the far right simultaneously. It's actually quite clever. I don't know that they intended to do that.
It's a Trump-Sanders ticket is what you're saying?
Yeah, anybody who's against government, against the media, who doesn't feel that they're being satisfied. And a senior person at RT actually commented that if the Western media was doing their job, RT wouldn't have a market.
I mean, the other thing, Jeff, is that in a digital space, as we now have, anybody has a voice, right? And if they're determined enough and put enough effort into it, they can put all sorts of things out. And if you don't care what the truth is anymore, if the truth doesn't matter to you, you can say anything. You can get plenty of attention for outrageous claims just because they're outrageous. They might not last very long. Over time, your credibility will be nothing. But you'll certainly get attention. RT has gotten attention. I would argue, however, they have not gotten much audience overall.
Just a point of reference, RT has 300 million subscribers on YouTube to CNN's 3 million. So they're not effective in certain media. I don't know exactly why, maybe in televised media, but on YouTube, they're dramatically effective, point number one. Point number two, it goes back to my question, is a democracy capable of waging an information war because the adversaries are doing things that are against our rules of engagement?
Well, on point number one, I'll just, maybe others want to, I'll just say this. RT has 300, I don't challenge your number, I know it's very high, because they have people who spend all day every day
trolls.
putting videos up that have already drawn large viewerships from anywhere on the web. So they just take, I'm not going to say cat videos, but, you know, things that have grabbed people's attention and throw them up there to drive their numbers up in a way that will cause you to quote them. So some of that is
if I'm an investor,
churn.
They're building market share to do whatever they need to do down the road. So I don't know that that's a criticism, actually.
Both RT
investor.
And actually ISIS do the same thing in this sense, is that they prioritize volume. Volume has value. We all know in our lives, how often have you seen somebody say something really stupid? You know, an individual saying something really stupid, who cares? 1,000 people, or 10,000, or 100,000, you have a movement, you have an echo chamber. That's right. And both the Islamic State and the social media space, and the Russians as well, know that, you know, saying that lie, saying that outrageous thing loud enough, strong enough, with enough conviction, has a certain amount of weight. And by the way, there's no reason that a democratic state can't do that and also be faithful to its values.
Right. Jeffrey. But also, if I can, there's the commercial media too. We're forgetting about that, right? One of the things that was interesting is the commercial media went after Tom Brokaw, right? Not Tom Brokaw, I'm sorry. Brian Williams. Went after Brian Williams. Why isn't the media going after RT? There is a responsibility here both to educate the consumer and to deal with the other media. There's an oversight here. And it's not just the role of the government. In fact, we as Americans have a real natural distrust of the government engaging in our domestic information sphere. That's the job of our media, but our media is simply not doing that.
Jeffrey.
Thank you, Jeff. Two points to this. First of all, back to foreign policy. I would like to see us have a thoughtful, robust foreign policy that pushes Russia back and contains Vladimir Putin. I think it becomes a different conversation. He cyber-attacked Estonia. He invaded Georgia. He annexed Crimea. Then he went into eastern Ukraine. And in all these markets across Europe and in eastern Europe, he has a multifaceted, specific strategy, a little bit different from Romania, a little bit different from Moldova. They acquire media, they set up radio, television, digital. It's robust. The first point I want to make is the moment that we start pushing back and containing, it'll make it a different sort of problem. Informationally, I would like to do that too. In large part, we run around Washington talking about what will Putin do next? And how should we respond? It's a great parlor game. I don't think he spends a lot of time in the Kremlin at night thinking, what will the Americans do next? And when they do it, you know, how will I respond? He is a kleptocratic, authoritarian ruler who is looting his country financially, spiritually, culturally. Liberal Democrats don't like him. But Russian nationalists should not like him either. So not only would I like to push him back in terms of our foreign policy objective, but we ought to be squeezing him constantly informationally so that he is on the defensive. Then it becomes a different conversation.
Jeffrey, an old Arkansas expression, we'll put you down as lukewarm on Putin.
I'm just trying to share.
When I think about our message of democracy, and I think about, and I'm a business guy, so to speak. I'm a professor of practice. I spent my life in the business world. If someone said, that's your job, sell democracy to, and I grew up in the Middle East for part of my life, I'd find a new job. I'd say, it's like having a Rubio moment. I just have to repeat the same line over and over and hope that they listen. How do we make a credible shot at convincing an indigenous people with an indigenous religion that we're on their side and we have something to say? Ambassador.
Well, I mean, that's a big question. We have a problem, and that problem is that we are confused. The Bush administration, and I've been, I'm on record criticizing some aspects of the Bush administration. The Bush administration had a clear vision for the Middle East. It was that the solution was a liberal democratic order. Maybe that was ridiculous, maybe that was too soon, maybe it was overstated, but they had a vision, they had something. You have to counter something with something. Right now, we basically have a void, a vacuum. I've spent most of my career in the Middle East and in the Arab world, and what the Arabs always joked about is that, you know, the Americans always had this struggle between al-masalih wal-mabadi', you know, principles and interests. But our interests always won out on our principles. We were never faithful to our principles. We never stood up to our principles. And what attracted them to us was our principles, was what America is really like, not the ugly aspects of foreign policy that they saw in the region, rightly or wrongly interpreted that way. So we have a good story to tell, but sometimes we trip over ourselves in trying to tell it.
And if, may I, Jeff, you know, we have a great story to tell. We have to have self-confidence in the story. We have to be self-aware and humble enough to share with the world that we haven't figured it all out. And if they watch our election campaign, they see we haven't figured it quite all out yet. But there's so many examples from public diplomacy and broadcasting where we get it right. And I'll give you one. When I was running RFERL, we had an Afghan service and a bureau in Kabul. I went. I had a meeting with some tribal leaders, okay? Men, tunics, long beards, okay? One of them said to me, you know, Dr. Gebran, we're a very religious, traditional, tribal society. We don't want to look like the United States of America or, he said, Southern California. And then he paused, I'm not kidding you, and he said, but some of us, he said, we pray five times a day. He said, but some of us do change our prayer schedules to listen to your programming, okay? True story. You know what our most popular program at that time, 4 years ago in Afghanistan was? It was a call-in show with an Afghan woman medical doctor, gynecologist on women's health. That's a tiny seed of hope and a big investment in the long game for a country like that.
I think
that.
It's a teachable moment here. How do we, and my next question was going to be, to paraphrase Tip O'Neill, all propaganda is local. How do we become adept at doing that kind of programming? And we'll figure out when to add the Democracy Channel, but if we've got to get their hearts and minds.
Yeah, I think we're on that path. Part of it had to do with a strategy and a purpose. Same thing as the foreign policy. I think the Broadcasting Board of Governors had a difficult time with the strategy. I'm on record as saying that the strategic plan that this agency has, jello nailed to a wall, has more consistency than the strategic plan. It was just so meaningless. And so it's we're starting to bring it together and get the five major entities, Radio Free Europe, Free Liberty, Radio Free Asia, Office Cooper Broadcasting, Voice of America, and Middle East Broadcast Network, aligned onto a mission, onto a target. And, you know, we don't do democracy promotion. In fact, I hate that. In support of freedom and democracy is our tagline. And I hate that because whose democracy are we talking about? Is it American, French, German, Italian? I don't know whose democracy it is. It's these building blocks. It's human security, it's health, rule of law, accountability. And for some of these audiences, because we operate in those audiences, as I say sometimes, where Special Operations Command is in or will go because we're in those denied space markets or those other difficult markets, they don't understand what accountability is. They don't know what civil-military relations are. They don't know how the policemen should work. They don't know that their government officials can be held accountable. And that's where we need to operate, is in that space, and it's below there. So how do we get there? I think now that we have the CEO, we're aligning the forces, and RFE, for example, and VOA have partnered on this current time program, and there's some 40 other programs, actually, which people generally don't know about. It's seen, so it's a partner project between VOA and RFE in this one slot. It's seen by about 2 million people in Russia every day, which a U.S. network would love to have a 2 million audience share for their news programming. And it's being, actually, VOA is being broadcast in Belarus because they have a concern about Russia. So I think we're starting to get the alignment there, and we're getting the systems and the gears in place. But it still goes back to, we're only a small little cog. We're only a small little bit. And there still has to be a foreign policy so that this can be more powerful.
Can I just add to what the governor said? The Voice of America over the last 4 years has increased its audience 40% to almost 188 million people watching, listening to, or reading Voice of America every week. Almost a quarter of the entire population of Iran watches at least one Voice of America television show every week. I don't know if people realize that is probably the largest impact on Iran, the public in Iran, that any nation has anywhere. And it's done by the U.S. government from a basement, you know, in downtown Washington. It's enormously impactful. when we do it by being a truthful broadcast. So, we do it by staying out of the propaganda side, or we're not a spokesman for the administration. For example, when Prime Minister Bibi Netanyahu of Israel gave his speech to the joint session of Congress, he wasn't exactly complimentary about Barack Obama's efforts in the Iraq nuclear deal. We ran it live with simultaneous translation in Farsi, because we knew that was what our Persian audience would want to see at that time, and it was a public service, and it was a way of saying, we're an open country. We don't all agree on everything.
And they're the most...
This is how you deal with a difficult issue. You debate it. You discuss it.
And they're the most educated audience in the Middle East.
It was a civics lesson for the rest of the world, the way we broadcast. So a lot of good things have happened in the last 4 years, and I think there's a lot more we can do. Digital media is an enormous opportunity. Most of that growth I just mentioned, the 40%, has actually been television, moving from radio to television.
I'm going to ask for your summaries in a second, so I just want to turn to Ambassador, who's had his hand up. Please.
I was going to say, we have also, a tremendous resource that most of the general public is not aware of. We've talked a lot about broadcasting, and that is the work of public diplomacy officers at American embassies and consulates overseas. These are the people that interact with publics in foreign countries, often in the language of the country. These are the people that administer our cultural exchange and scholarship programs and deal with the local media. These are people doing tremendous work. We have lousy leadership at the high levels of government in this field, as far as I'm concerned. But the working level people, the young diplomats and senior diplomats too, who are doing this work, are actually doing really good stuff.
I'm going to ask the team, the A team, if they would, they're welcome to give a summary or talk about how we fix this. I put it as a roadmap to victory, but I'll give you a swing thought before you launch into it. Chesterton, the British historian, said that people didn't love Rome because she was great. She was great because they loved her. And as I look around the world, despise our adversaries, I think they love their countries. David and I were talking about how fragmented our country is. I'm wondering, do we, leadership, love our country enough to be able to unify around strategies, around messaging to fix this problem? I'll start, and anyone who wants to start.
Should we go down the line?
Sure. Okay. I'll jump on that first. I don't know that it's an issue of loving the country. I think it's an issue of understanding that the boundaries are gone and that foreign policy matters and that you can't pretend to be isolationist, pretend that this is all Las Vegas. This is a global environment. And what happens here influences elsewhere, and what happens there influences here, and we need to pay attention to that. Foreign policy matters. So I would rephrase it, and I don't think that we get that what we say can sometimes overwhelm, I'm sorry, what we do can sometimes overwhelm what we say. I also want to echo what was just said, is that we have these public diplomacy officers as within the Foreign Service Office, which is a subset of the Foreign Service, and the hiring is going down. And I have yet to see a Secretary of State go to the Hill and say, I need more public diplomacy officers. I've yet to see that this century. That has not happened. So despite my agency, and while my agency needs more money, the tip of the spear, the people are on the ground, are under-resourced, overworked, not supported by the human resource system, and I'll bet you that none of you know that. It'd be remarkable. And they're the ones out there engaging, and they barely have time to get out into the field. And that is a critical component of our foreign policy, is being able to execute. So it's one thing to have a foreign policy. It's another thing, what are we doing on the ground, and how are we able to fix and get around the dysfunction?
David?
How are we going to win the information war, or do something, or even start to get better at it? Back in the 60s, John F. Kennedy had as his chief information advisor a man whose picture is in the Cronkite Museum over there of journalism, Edward R. Murrow. One of the finest journalists our country's ever produced. A really smart guy, and on many, many levels. That was who advised the president at that time. It was taken seriously. And we had USIA, which frankly I in some ways regret was abolished in 1999 as a peace Cold War dividend. I'm not suggesting we put it back in place, but we really need to take this subject far more seriously than we do. That's the real headline here. There's a lot we can have. There's a lot of impact we can have in this area if we take it seriously. The British take it seriously. Look at the BBC World Service. Given the size of the country and the size of the budget of that country, that's an extraordinary investment by our allies, the British. And they are the most respected broadcasters on earth, bar none, without any question, with an audience of 300 million people who trust that broadcaster. That's the model we should emulate, not the model of RT and CCTV. I don't envy them in the least bit. I wouldn't want their communications problem because they're selling something that doesn't sell very well. That said, when you have the kinds of budgets that they have, I sure wouldn't mind having some of the producers they've got and the snazzy sets and the ability to have bureaus in lots of places that are well supplied. So I just think we should, as a country, just take this a little more seriously. One more thought on the broader area. I thought Martha Bale's book that a friend of Jeff's and mine recently about the impact of public culture was instructive. There was a time when American movies, which have always been popular and still are around the world, were a tremendously positive force for the image of our country around the world. And I still think, you know, movies like The Martian and Spotlight are very positive in that regard. But a lot of our movies are frankly very violent, often very sexual in content, in ways that other cultures just don't like, don't appreciate. They don't export very well. And parents around the world don't like their children being exposed to all the violence. So I don't know what the answer is there, because I'm not asking for censorship. But I think that some conversations ought to go on in this country about our public culture. And some thought ought to go into what we want, how we want to be seen by the rest of the world.
Ambassador.
I'm one of those that I will go where no man wants to go. And that is to say, I think we do need something like USIA. We need an entity in the U.S. government whose job it is to do advocacy for the United States. And I am unashamed to say that. We have a tremendous story to tell. We have we have things that we can be true to ourselves about. And so I believe that having an entity whose job it is to do that, and only that, that is adequately resourced and that has access to the top of the government, that has access, like Edward R. Murrow had briefly in the 1950s and early 60s, USIA was part of cabinet meetings and would go to meetings where, you know, important things were decided. Then after a while was kind of, well, don't call us, we'll call you. We'll let you know if we need anyone to talk about propaganda. So I think that we need to treat it, as I said in my opening remarks, we need to treat it with the very same seriousness and passion that our adversaries do.
Just as an aside, Murrow was moved out of his job, eased out of it to make way for Walter Cronkite, just in the random crazy way the world works sometimes. Jeffrey, last words.
Jeff, thank you. USIA, U.S. Information Agency. I too would advocate something like that because it's a sign of seriousness and investment, and the fact is we've tried a decade and a half without it and we haven't been terribly successful. Second point, to David's remark about this book by Martha Bayless, Yale University Press on American Public Diplomacy and Culture. It's a great book, and it's very instructive because David's right, we don't want censorship, but it may suggest some thoughtfulness and restraint on our part. You know, not only is it that some cultures around the world don't like the dreadful, gratuitous violence and dehumanization of people, maybe some Americans want to give it a second thought, too. It does have some effect on who we are and how we project. The third and last thing I'd say is raise your hand if you would, if you've ever seen RT. Okay, so many of you have. RT's secret ingredient is simply this. You know, we talk about the war, the battle of hearts and minds. They have lots of mind stuff, information. They're about hearts. And if you watch it, they're about narratives, okay? And what they do is they feed the cynicism and passivity that exists across the West. I call it the yes but crowd. I moved back to the United States from London last year. If you go to a dinner in London with politicians or business people or culture people, the dinners are mostly dominated by the yes but crowd. You know, you say, he annexed Crimea. Well, the Americans went into Iraq. China is corrupt. Well, Italy is corrupt too. You know, it's this moral relativism that seeps in everywhere. Of course we have problems, but not all problems or relationships are equal and morally equivalent. The last thing I want to say is we have an information challenge, we have a foreign policy challenge, but I think we have a challenge to get back to the idea that we stand for something, that it's universal, that it's okay to advocate accountable government, pluralism, tolerance, respect for diversity, and that we tolerate everything, but we don't tolerate hatred and violence that's being promoted. But I think we're right now a little bit uncertain about those things. When we clear that up, it will help the rest of the things quite a bit, I think.
Stay for questions, but join me in congratulating and thanking this panel.
I'm taking pages from your book, you know.
Now, the only instruction I have is if you ask a question, I'm going to repeat it. That has to do with the streaming and the miking. So please fire away. Whoever wants to stand up, please.
There hasn't been one independent of the Russian government since MTV. And then specifically on Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, I feel that they're more and more advocating in Washington policy decisions rather than broadcasting into the region. Is that to justify funds for the organization, or is that an additional mission of the organization? It just seems like that they're doing far more on broadcasting or advocating in Washington than their core mission.
I won't repeat it. That is a Mensa test, and I think I'll pass that opportunity. Panel.
Can I do the first half, and you take a second? On the first half, we talk about this. When I was director, we talked about it every day, and I'm sure Jeff also spent a lot of time on it. Here's a thought, one that I used to bat around with people. Look, Putin threw us out of all of the radio and television stations pretty much in Russia itself, Russia proper. But there's the area of Russian speakers in what used to be the Soviet Union that is underserved and we should reach with better programming. That's why we did Nastayashie Vremya, Current Time, in partnership with RFE, and it is reaching some audience even inside Russia through streaming on their computers. How about this for an idea? What if we were able to find a private partner or a private individual who wanted to start an eye candy television station in Kiev or Vilnius that would have the best soap operas, where the Western governments would have helped them to get some of the best sports clearances, live sports coverage that Russians just can't resist, and then on that same station, there could be public affairs programming and news programming that might be done by the RFE Russian Language Service, by Voice of America's Language Service, by Deutsche Welle's Language Service, and also by local Russians who would work for this station that would be in a place outside Russia. If we did that, even though Putin is blocking broadcast over the air, I think that stuff would get in. YouTube clips are everywhere in Russia. If you put something compelling on and you find ways to chop it up into bite-sized bits and put it on the web, they get all over the place in Russian if it's compelling enough. We could even perhaps look at, and frankly this is an engineering question I don't entirely know the answer to, but I was told by one engineer that it would be perhaps possible to get a signal from northeastern Estonia to St. Petersburg, the second largest city in Russia, if you put the right equipment up. So I think we could do so. We could be doing so much more than we are. And I really think we should have responded more forcefully in this area as well as others when Crimea was invaded.
I'll just add to that. Did I tell you I like David Ensor? I think that's vision and strategy. If you can't play the inside game, you play the outside game. He's closed us down, Vladimir Putin, mostly in the inside game, because, you know, ostensibly he believes in rule of law. I have to say parenthetically, you know, one of my claims to fame was seeing our operation decline inside Russia, because every partner you worked with, if there's a piece of cheese out for an hour, the health inspector came, or the fire inspector, or the tax collector, they made it impossible to do business there. Inside game, very, very difficult. Outside game, that's imaginative, that's vision, that's strategy. And by the way, these things don't cost that much. I mean, really. Let me take my former company. One tiny piece of the bigger puzzle. RFERL, when I was there, less about $100 million budget. If you want to know, that's the cost of about 4 Apache helicopters. Okay? And they got lots of those things over at the Pentagon. That's about half of what PBS spends in New York City. So if you believe in these things, hearts and minds, and we did 28 languages in 22 countries, okay, it's real money, but in context, a big, rich country like this, I think we could afford it. David, to your question, they broadcast robustly, they're present, as I said, 28 languages, 22 countries. They do have a presence in Washington. It is in part to make sure that the funder, the U.S. Congress, knows that they're alive and kicking, because they don't broadcast in English. So that presence and visibility is important. But it was actually greater during the Cold War, because there's something called the RFE Research Institute. It was in Munich, but it had a subsidiary in Washington, which was very significantly staffed that was analysts. So I think you're right, but I don't think it's a terrible thing.
So can I add
yes,
something
please.
On the board? I'm going to be additive here. I'll work in reverse order. The presence of RFE in D.C. I think has shifted slightly over these last just couple of years. The presence is important, just like all the entities are important to be in D.C. There's not a strong awareness because the English language side, RFE does operate in English, but it's a subset because it's not a core language, just like VOA does operate in English. But for most of the last 15 years, there have been attempts to abolish it or just minimize it. It's not the way to look at VOA and understand what it does, because it operates in other languages primarily.
Except in Africa, where it's huge.
And so the reality is that it's not operating too much there. But you asked this other point about, okay, how do we collect something? How do we engage in this Russian language space or any of the other languages in the Russian periphery? And one of the things I've done several times is get out into the space and see how we can collect and get together. I called it the NPR model. And I did this about a year and a half, 2 years ago, because we found that there were somewhere around 25 hours of good quality Russian language programming not made by Russia. Because the beauty of the Kremlin, is that they're able to produce all this really shiny, great content. And they brought in Soviet TV stars and movie stars, and they create this great shiny box. And everybody's a deer in headlight. All the other entities, all the different countries. And they produce 30 minutes here, 15 minutes there, 10 minutes there. BBC was doing 10 minutes. In fact, BBC is only upping their Russian language programming from 10 minutes a day to 30 minutes a day in 2 months, because they had diminished it. So I went out, let's all produce something. And let's all put it into a pot, and let's pull it out. So if we get 25 countries or 25 hours put in, we can pull out and have 6 hours each or something like that. And so we started to ramp up. Some of the countries weren't sure what to do. They still sort of froze. We started to move. Then there was a European Endowment for Democracy project that kind of came up with the same thing. They called it the Content Factory and a News Exchange, two different components to produce, submit, share. So, and there's some other efforts that are going on as well. It's pretty much three simultaneous efforts. So we're still working on how do we provide this news and information? How do we provide this quality content? State Department assisted us to get PBS content, you know, government-funded content. How do we pull that in? Because BBG is not funded to do entertainment. So how do we pull in this other content? Netflix, our target markets see Netflix going global as a great hurrah. Because now, so how do we synchronize with that? And what's missing from that Netflix catalog that audience may want? So the point is we're starting to spin that up. There are activities that are happening now.
some U.S. government, some private sector. But it is a complex, dynamic environment.
Go to our next question, please. I'll try to paraphrase it. You probably got the question. He wanted to know about Sky News, right?
Yeah.
And how they... To combat ISIS?
Yeah, that's an ISIS question. There are two questions.
Okay.
Sky News and an ISIS question.
I'm not doing a very good job here as the interlocutor, but why don't you guys take it away?
I don't know anything about Sky News.
I'm not sure what the question is about Sky News.
So is your question really about the ISIS propaganda?
Yeah, when it talked about RT News spreading Russian
propaganda.
Sky News is a private company,
right.
Which is a news company in the UK.
Are they doing
which is on the satellite and therefore is seen in a lot of other countries as well?
But are they doing what RT is doing? Is Sky News doing the same thing, or is it a straight news?
It's a commercial news company. Yeah. It's a profit-based, fact-based news company.
It's like CNN, is what we're saying.
Yes.
It's like you understand. It's like CNN. It's not propaganda, but.
NBC or
I mean, but it can
they
be.
You
may or may not like how they do it, or what you perceive to be their underlying views. But they are a commercial company, purporting to do news on a fact-based basis. And they're not a propaganda company.
And stay after. We'd be happy to try to take another shot at the question. Please. I think the question is there a mirror relationship between what has happened in private media and in...
I'm a former CNN correspondent, so I'll respond. Yes, I mean, look, this is the story of my career in some ways. I was a foreign affairs correspondent for ABC News when they had 13 overseas bureaus. Now they have one. I worked at CNN covering national security policy. Now most of the coverage on CNN of national security policy is really homeland security policy. Although, yes, there is some international coverage too, and some of it's very, very good. So yes, there's been a shift in the focus of the American media. I think the end of the Cold War, our country felt, great, done, halas, that's it. You know, we don't have to have 13 ABC News bureaus around the world anymore, because our biggest problem is solved. And, of course, how wrong that was. One of the reasons I liked being director of Voice of America was because it was publicly funded. I was a private commercial journalist for most of my career, and I'm proud of the work we did. I think there's some great journalism, and then comes the word but. But Voice of America, it doesn't have to bleed to lead. It doesn't have to be bad news to be news. I mean, I've been in the business all my life, and I've seen many a survey, and the sad news about humanity is human beings are more interested in bad news than good news. They're more likely to keep watching if things are blowing up or sad things are happening than they are if there's good news. It's just a fact about us. It's very challenging to get something on the air in a network news program, which is commercial, that is good news. You can do it, but it's harder. So I used to love that at VOA, or when I was a diplomat in Afghanistan, A public broadcaster could decide that, you know, the opening of 20 health clinics today is just as big a story as that bomb that killed two people. We're going to do both equally. Maybe we might even emphasize the health clinics, because that's actually quite big news for the Afghan people, and they want to know about it. So, you know, you have, it depends what model your journalism is and what drives it. The profit motive, I believe in there being commercial journalism. Most of my life I was a commercial journalist, and we did some great work, and I think we informed a lot of people, entertained and informed people about what's going around. And I still very strongly believe in that model, but I like a mix. And I like to see some public broadcasting. And I think that Voice of America, in many of the markets where we're strong, provides news that is, the news judgments are based around, well, what do we actually think matters to these people? Not that it'll keep them transfixed necessarily, but that will matter to them over the longer term. And in some ways, it's kind of nice to be able to have the luxury of making judgments along those lines.
I'll use my privilege just to, we criticize the media, but the truth and the fact is that it was private media, those glory days, or they had been recently private. I worked for Forbes all my life, and I can assure you, if Malcolm Forbes wanted to write good news, he wrote good news, but he didn't answer to shareholders. So it's the transformation to public companies that has naturally changed the shape of the media. So what I'm saying is we're not blaming the media. As public companies, they do what they do.
Can I add to that? So it's a really good question. In the debates around the information, it doesn't come up. One thing that I think is useful to know is that all the BBG entities, RFE and VOA, now that they're under the roof, the job is to go out of business. Where the private media is deemed to be doing an adequate job, it is to go. Now, David has a different view of this, but in the authorizing legislation, there is this non-compete. Now, it should be changed, but this was the fundamental idea, is that it doesn't compete with commercial media.
It was the idea of the radio freeze, Matt. It was not the idea of Voice of America.
It was. You'll see the book. It's very clear. It's very clear.
Wait
it's
for the
absolutely
book.
Clear.
I think there always needs it's to be Voice of America.
Well, they didn't. The government didn't want to be in the news business. That was the job of the private sector.
But you're not going to find a profitable company that's going to broadcast in Hausa in northern
that's
Nigeria.
That's the point.
So it's not happening.
The media space.
Gentlemen,
there.
We've got so many questions.
So this is where it's an interesting mix.
We're going to go all the way down to the end and work my way to the middle.
What do you think of Justin Trudeau's
I don't think it's much of a factor. I think it's more has to do with domestic foreign policy. Look at me, you know, I'm so fuzzy and nice and everything like that. I really don't think that it has a deep influence in the region. It's good for Canada, it's good for him, it's good for his party, but I don't see that it has a major impact in the region, certainly. It's not something that people are talking about in Arabic.
Question at the end.
I believe by definition, propaganda is misleading information. So if we're having an information war, is it appropriate for the public, you know, democracy to put out misleading or false information to try to win misinformation?
Not at all. The best propaganda is the truth. And by the way, the word propaganda acquires this negative connotation because of World War II, and the Nazis have a ministry of propaganda. I'm a Roman Catholic, and for many years, the Catholic Church had the office of the propaganda that propagated the faith, and that's a good thing. So, I was once told by an Undersecretary of State, don't use the word propaganda, it scares people, but I use it anyway.
I mean, I would even add just very briefly, not only is it a terrible idea, as your question suggested, but credibility is the heart of all of this. And very quickly, once I went to Uzbekistan, I met with a small group of young people who followed our programs there. They were giggling the whole time. And I finally said, why are you laughing? And they said, because we think you are programs generated by the CIA. And I said, okay, but if that's the case, why do you listen to us? And they said, well, it always turns out to be accurate and truthful. Well, okay.
Question here, please.
Don't you think that calling this terrorist organization Islamic State contributes to the amalgam between Islam and terrorism?
I do not. I think that there's a kind of fantasy that if you call them Daesh, and most people can't even pronounce it, it sounds like they're saying dash or dish. I don't think people who, you know, who don't really know Arabic shouldn't say words in Arabic that way. Look, the Islamic State is imbued and saturated with a specific view of Islam. That needs to be confronted. Maybe not by us, because maybe we're not credible enough. But the idea that somehow we're going to cover our eyes and pretend that they are, you know, apostates, like Imam Kerry recently said, you know, is ridiculous. You know, the Islamic State has a history of Takfiri Salafi jihadism, which has a past. It doesn't come from nowhere. And so let's call them, you know, let's call them what they call themselves, and then let's prove them wrong.
You're saying it's a brand.
Yes, it's a brand. And the brand needs to be discredited, maybe not by us, but by others need to explain why it's not truly Islamic and challenge them on the words that they use, because they say, and they can back it up, that everything they do is found in the language and the thought of the Salaf and the Sahaba, you know? So that's where Muslims need to fight that battle. When they talk about kufr, right? When they talk about shirk, that's a challenge for Muslims to take on. It's not a challenge for me to take on. So I think kind of closing our eyes to the kind of ideological, political, religious challenge of it, which is connected to Islam, is something that needs to be taken on. Not by us, but it's a fight that has to happen. And by the way, many Muslims are doing that today. But we need more help.
Question?
I'm not aware of U.S. corporate media being self-censoring because of the fear of hackers or denial of service attacks. I'm not aware of any of that coming up.
Please.
And then we see it in college. Young people don't know basic foundations to our government. So how can media help that K-12? And marketing it in terms of how you referenced it, Ambassador, how do we do the fresh, aspiring work as opposed to the sick pornography of violence that David, in terms that you used?
Well, you know, I think you raise a really important question. You know, when we use words like propaganda, or when we use words like ideology, right, it kind of scares people. But there are other words we can use, like civics, right? Like social responsibility, like pluralism. And, you know, and this actually goes to ISIS as well. There's a vacuum that exists in the world today in actually educating people across the board. When I was in Europe recently, I actually had a discussion with Europeans who were concerned about ISIS radicalizing people, and I told them, I said, look, America has many faults and many problems, and we have challenges of radicalization in our country, but there is, and I'm a person who's a refugee and a person who's a migrant, I was not born in the United States, but the American ideal has power. When I see Glory, have you ever seen Glory? I cry like a baby at the end of that movie. it has power to influence people, to inspire people. And we do ourselves a disservice when we don't give people that, those tools. Like I said, when I was in Europe, I was shocked because I asked these Europeans, I said, well, if you're a Dane or a German or, you know, what can a young Muslim aspire to? What are the national symbols? What are the things that move you? And this one person from Scandinavia said, well, we can't talk about those things because in our country, national symbols and concepts are part of the far right. And I was taken aback. I thought, how are you going to counter something with nothing? So you need to educate people up in a positive way, you know, and let them not be ignorant.
Question here.
Thank you. Well, I mean, first of all, that's a very good question. First of all, one of the things about the ISIS message, it's not about one thing. It's a multifaceted message. For example, we've talked about religion, and certainly religion is a part of their message. But it's also an appeal to violence. It's an appeal to a utopian future. It's a tailored message for different people. So a message that they want to send to, for example, a young woman in the United States is a different message they're going to send to a Tunisian living in a slum outside of Tunis. So they tailor their message to their local audience, to the people they're talking to. There's a problem with ISIS, which is this. It's part of a larger phenomenon. In the Sunni Arab Muslim world, which is the part I know best, there has been for decades an investment in a certain worldview. It didn't just happen overnight. Look at an Arab movie from the 1940s. Look at an Egyptian movie from the 1940s. It's like a Hollywood movie. Yeah. Women, very lovely, and you know, and men with, you know, fezes and tuxedos and very suave and stuff like that. Our friends in the Gulf invested over time in a certain worldview and moved the needle in a certain direction. They moved the discourse in a certain direction. They poisoned the wells in a certain direction and promoted intolerance and extremism. And ISIS is the bitter fruit of decades of investment in that type of worldview. The tragedy is, and you mentioned it in the beginning of your remarks, is to this day, there are Arabs and Muslims, sincere Muslims, secularists, liberals, people of all sorts who are fighting that fight, but they are political and economic orphans. They don't have television stations. They don't have publishing houses. They don't have voice. I mean, they have voices, but their voices are not like some wacky sheikh saying some stupid thing. If you look at the stuff that we have on memory, you know, we often find people saying ridiculous things. There are people saying good things and positive things, but they don't have the clout and the podium that the crazies often do.
Please. I'm like a air traffic controller on Thanksgiving Wednesday here.
Well, my question is, when you have an adversary who kind of uses technological advances and advances in cognitive science and political psychology, which kind of you brought as a Western world, how do you find that kind of adversary with the same tools that he actually uses against you? Don't you have to change a level playing game? Don't you have to change the message? Because I believe we kind of live, at least in the West, in a post-ideological world. How do you fight with something which is a pure ideology, as Ambassador was just saying? Or why don't you tackle the source itself, which most of us actually know where the source of the ideology is. So how do you frame the message differently and still stay in the frames of political correctness of the West?
Well, first of all, I want to reiterate, I don't think we want to go to messaging or propaganda or psyops. I mean, there's a place and time in the Pentagon when you're fighting a war where you have specific requirements. But we're talking about public diplomacy, and we're talking about broadcasting, and I think I speak for everybody. You know, we want accurate, reliable, verifiable, truthful information because it means credibility, it's consonant with our values, and it wins in the end. The other thing I would say is simply, and of course ISIS is different from Russia and Russia is different from China, but the other thing I want to say is we have, if you think, what is this expression, you know, if you don't know where you're going, any road will do. I mean, we have an idea where we're going, right? And I'm reverting some of the things David said at the top of the program. There is a need, no matter who does it or how you divvy it up, there is a need to talk to the world about the United States of America in an accurate, reliable, truthful sort of way. And commercial media and social media doesn't get it done. It does some of it, but it's incomplete for reasons David said, and I'll even say we're so slaves to Mark. And so, I mean, go to YouTube. How many pictures and images do we need of cats putting up toilet seats, right? But that trumps everything else, okay? Those are numbers, baby, okay? So we need a public outlet that helps to communicate in all our complexity and contradiction us, American world. Second of all, we need to communicate about our policies responsibly, intelligently, not propagandistically, to engage people in a discussion about what they're all about. And third, we need to support, I think, democratic aspirants around the world to lift civil society, because it's the right thing to do. But in the long term, they will be more peaceful, more prosperous, and better partners. So what am I saying? Propaganda, no. Long term, yes. And basically, in a lot of ways, keep it simple. You're trying to do sensible, accurate, reliable journalism in service of a purpose.
We have run out of time, but we haven't run out of ideas. So if you want to run up to the front and say a few questions, I'm sure we'll be able to take them. But join me in thanking this wonderful panel for a rousing discussion. And to recognize Ambassador Volker for making all this happen. Thank you.
And please join me in thanking Jeff Cunningham for doing a super job moderating.
And while I'm at it, in this room I'll be interviewing Senator John McCain a week from tomorrow at 2 p.m. That's Friday, is that the 19th?
Yes,
at 2 p.m.
Friday the 19th.
You're all welcome to join.
Thank you for coming this evening. Thank you.